You're on the air, sir. You're on the air. You want me to introduce you first? It's up to you also.
I defer. So whatever you decide.
Okay. Unless you see, can. I think this will pick up.
Really?
No.
Okay.
You can try. Okay.
All right.
Brothers, do you mind please to come closer? Because when these people from outside come, they're going to be blocking the doors. Thank you very much. I appreciate this.
الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين. طيب, so my name is Abdullah Al-Ansari and I want to do a little plug for what I do before I start with the actual lecture. And I want to solicit you. You don't think I'm loud enough without it? Okay, Jim. So as I said, my name is Abdullah Al-Ansari, and what I do is I'm the senior Muslim chaplain for the South Carolina Department of Corrections. And I want to do a little plug for that before I actually begin the actual lecture. Does anybody know how many prisons we have in South Carolina? State prisons. State.
25.
A lot. 22. Somebody said 27. Right there. You're right. You guys are all right there in the ballpark. It's actually about 24. 24, okay? Now, 24 prisons, and they're not centrally located, which means they're dispersed throughout the state. Some of them are 2 hours distance from, a two-hour drive from Columbia. I mean, every bit of 2 hours. Okay? Now imagine, 24 prisons, one chaplain, two-hour drive for some of them. With me so far?
No.
All right, imagine that I wanted to go and teach our Muslim brothers and sisters in Islam in the prison system every day. How many days in a week? How many days in a week, not including Saturday and Sunday?
Five.
How many weeks in a month?
Four.
Do the math. How many days in a month?
20.
How many prisons?
24.
If I went to each prison every day, a month would go by and some prisons wouldn't see me. Now, one visit a month, basically is what we're saying. One visit a month and I stay for 2 hours, let's say. So 2 hours a month to study your religion and learn it. How long do you think it would take you to gain mastery, gain proficiency, gain literacy in your religion if you studied it once a month for 2 hours?
20 years of life.
It would take a long time. Everybody agree with that?
Yeah.
Take a long time, okay? So these are the conditions of our brothers in the prisons. Add to that, if at the same time you're being taught authentic Islam once a month for 2 hours, and the other days of the month you're being bombarded with what? With personal interpretations of Islam. Prison interpretations of Islam, where they mix, for example, gang understandings, different perspectives, different denominations, sects of Islam. They take from each sect and then they create what? They create a fusion that they call Islam, which has gang elements, has Sunni elements, may have Shi'i elements, might have elements of a tasawwuf in it. You're being bombarded with that. And then somebody comes and tells you the right thing. Let's just hope, inshallah, we're telling them the right thing for 2 hours. How long do you think it would take then for you to gain legitimate understanding of your faith. You might not ever, right? So the point I'm trying to make is that I need help. I need help. And that's where you come in. I would really appreciate if brothers who have time, and brothers and sisters, I should say, brothers and sisters who have time and interest, if they would volunteer. And I would be willing to basically come to wherever you are in South Carolina and spend time training volunteers on how to teach. I have a tentative proposed curriculum. I have texts. I have solicited donations, and people have given me money to buy texts for the inmates. They'll have their own personal libraries in addition to a community library. But what I need now is I need personnel to do what? To teach, because I can't be everywhere all the time. And I would be willing to come to your city and spend a weekend and do a Dora, do a weekend workshop from Fajr to Isha, and teach you the curriculum. I would supply you with the materials. I would supply you with lesson plans, supply you with everything you need. Once I prepare you, you can go right into prison and do what? Set up shop and teach. And it's not, I think some people, they have the interest, they have the desire to do da'wah, which is what we're going to talk about in some detail, but they're afraid. They think, they hear the word prison, and they think about things that they've seen in movies that they've watched. But wallahi, ikhwani, you go into the prison and you meet with brothers who are so soft-hearted, who are so thirsty and interested in learning about Islam. You're not gonna be harmed. You're not gonna be harassed. Your life is not gonna be threatened. You're gonna find people who will sit at your feet and listen attentively to everything you have to say. So it's a fursa. People who are serious about da'wah, this is an opportunity. And I hope you'll seize the opportunity. What I have is I have a roster. I have two of them. One for women and one for men. If you have interest, I'm gonna pass it around as I speak. Just write your name, your phone number, your email address, and your city, and I'll be in touch. Sound good? Sound fair?
No.
No.
I thought the lecture is about something different.
It's about da'wah, but we had to do a plug. I had to take this opportunity. So I'm going to start here. I'm going to give this to my brother.
What is the hours like, brother?
And then it will be, that's the thing too, it's open. It's here on your schedule. It will be totally open. It will be up to your schedule. And we can work with the institutional chaplain. So if you need to go on a Saturday, for example, I'm free on Saturday mornings. Can you give this one to the sisters? I'm free on Saturday mornings from 11 to 12. Okay, we'll work that out. We'll work that out. And just imagine there were two or three people, if there were two or three people in a locality. Let's say, for example, two or three people in Greenville. And they each had different schedules, different availabilities. One of them 11 to 12 on Saturday. One 6 to 8 on Monday evening. And one 5 to 7 on Thursday. The inmates could get taught three times a week. I mean, come on, man. That's three times more than I could do it. No, that's even more than that, because we said once a month, right? So if they got 3 days a week times 4 weeks, we're talking about 12 times, that's 12 more times than I could do it in a month. Isn't that much better? Doesn't that give them a greater chance of really learning their deen properly and practicing it? And not only this, think about this, you're gonna change people's lives. This Islam is the fastest growing religion in the prison system, and it is changing people's lives. And we have the opportunity to be a part of that. And you talk about sadaqah jariyah, talking about the sadaqah that you want to leave behind. This is it, ya ikhwani. This is your chance. Fursa. I'm telling you, it's a chance. So seize it. Hope to hear from all of you. Hope all your names will be on there. And if it is, you'll be hearing from me. Wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa barak and Ibn Muhammad. Let's go eat.
Lunch?
No, I think they, I think I promised them something.
Nobody signs the paper, guys. You're not signing the paper.
This is only for South Carolina, right?
It's only for South Carolina, but if you live in North Carolina, you live on the border, that doesn't mean you couldn't come across and volunteer. So understand that.
Virginia.
Whoa, that's kind of far. Maybe we could fly you in. We could fly you in. We'll see. We'll see about that.
How about the juvenile system?
Now, I don't particularly work with the juvenile system, but I'm sure they would appreciate it.
holy guys.
Volunteers. But yeah, they're going to get mad if we start taking questions on this subject.
No. The lecture, brother.
Okay, I'll give you the lecture, and then after that we can ask questions about...
Exactly. People can sit and eat and talk. You understand while you're eating, they can talk and like this. Okay? But who needs the lecture, brother?
Like, okay. About, I guess it's close about 20 years ago now, Brother Zabri had started a program, and I was a member of it.
Alhamdulillah.
Myself and about four or five other brothers.
Jameel.
And we did just what you were talking about. We traveled around and went. He got us into the different prisons. They'd know when we were coming. They'd come together, and he would bring other people, other inmates that were interested in learning about Islam.
Jameel.
And we'd give them literature and have a little lecture. And alhamdulillah, you know, worked out. And like you said, I didn't realize there were so many prisons.
Too many. May Allah help us. May Allah help us. But I don't want to make the Sheikh mad or make him any angrier than he already is. So let me keep my promise. I came here to talk about Adawil Allah and techniques. And give a few words or say a few words about techniques and methods. Taib, techniques and methods. So let's get right to it.
Jameel.
So the first thing is that we talk about this concept of techniques and methods, right? Techniques and methods. And the word that we commonly would use, bil Arabi, in Arabic, is wasa'il. Wasa'il. Word used all the time in this context. Wasa'il al-da'wah. You're going to hear it a lot. And there's another word that's also used. Asalib. Asalib, we could probably best translate it as techniques and approaches. Techniques and approaches. Wasa'il, I would translate it as means or methods. Okay? But to be honest with you, from a practical perspective, a lot they're pretty much related. They can all fall in the umbrella of what? Wasa'il. This concept of what? Wasa'il. Exactly. And what do we mean by wasa'il? كل ما يتوصل به إلى شيء مقصود. Anything that you use as a means to what? To reach an end. That's what we mean by wasa'il. And so what we're talking about are those means, those methods, those approaches, those techniques that we use to do what? To achieve our objective of what? Calling to Allah. Inviting people to what? To the deen of Allah. طيب. We could add another word, منهج. So we hear a lot, for example, منهج الدعوة. Or منهج الأنبياء في الدعوة. When we talk about منهج, we're talking about what now? Talk about a framework. Talking about a framework, a methodological framework that governs and regulates all that we do. Everything. And inside of that, we have what? Wasa'il. So basically, those wasa'il have to be within this framework. Does that sound right? Does that make sense so far? So we have minhaj, it's broader, big frame, sets limits. And then you have what? Wasa'il, which are a little bit more, they have a little bit more freedom. But do we have absolute freedom when it comes to wasa'il? Which brings us to a question that's commonly asked. هل وسائل الدعوة توقيفية أم اجتهادية? Are these techniques and these methods, are they something which is توقيفي? توقيفي means that it's something fixed by a shari'ah, the lawgiver. Who's the lawgiver? Allah. Jalla Jalaluhu wa Adhamah Sultanu. Or his deputy. Who's his deputy? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we say tawqifi, we mean something which has been fixed, has been set in stone by Allah or his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's it. And you can't change it. You can't fix it. Like what? Like al-ibadah. Like worship. We pray five times a day. Salat itself, the act of worship is what? Tawqifi. The number of times we pray a day. Huh? Tawqifi. Something that is fixed, we can't change it. Can't make it six, can't make it four. Obligatory, obviously. Okay, we're talking about the obligatory. So this is a question you're going to be asked, or which is asked a lot. And when it's asked, scholars that we respect and we love, they give different answers. And that leads to confusion. That leads to confusion. In the fact, some of the scholars that we respect and love will be asked the question more than once. in different settings, and they'll give different answers. One scholar, more than one fatwa, more than one ruling on this subject, are the wasat of a da'wah tawqifi. And what happens is that the du'at themselves, because of these different fatawa, they do what? They become divided. They become two groups on the subject. Those who say they're tawqifiyya, those who say they're not tawqifiyya, they're ijtihadiyya, and those two groups start to do what? Start to fight amongst themselves. They start fighting amongst themselves, and this one calls this one a mubtada, and this one calls this one mutashaddid, mutaannit, right? That's what happens. Ulla.
After this, no da'wah.
Right, and they busy themselves with each other, and they don't, mashallah, mumtaz, it's a good interjection, I appreciate that. Don't let it happen again. Right. All right, so now what we're going to do, first of all, ya ikhwani, wa akhwati, is I'm going to throw out some wasa'il. Because I want to come back to this whole point of tawqifiyya or ijtihadiyya. I'm going to come back to that. Before we do that, though, I'm going to throw out some wasa'il. All right, and what we're going to do is we're going to put them in two categories, and I want you to use your gut right now.
It's empty.
Use your gut, okay? Your gut feeling, all right? All right. So I want you to use your gut feeling, okay? And put in one of the two categories, all right? Use your gut feeling. And then after that, we're going to come back, and I'm going to do something that scholars, unfortunately, some scholars, they don't do. They themselves, they have it up here, but they need to give it to you so we don't have the type of confusion that we're having. And that is what, I'm going to give you a qa'idah. I'm going to give you a dhabit, a principle, a maxim, that we use to determine, is this wasila allowed or not? If we just use this maxim, all the fighting stops. But what happens is that they use the fatwa. Which shows you the danger of these fatawa, especially when they're used as if they're what? Shara. From to me, Akhwan, you guys understand that? Shows you the danger, okay? So better than that, let's use what? The qawaid that the scholars themselves use to make the fatawa. Doesn't that make sense? So okay, طيب. So we'll start with what? We'll start with what? La? Oh, come on, man.
Okay, it's okay.
Who brought this marker?
No, it's it. Alhamdulillah.
Where's my marker, man?
Keep right.
No, I'm just joking. I just wanted to play with him, that's all.
Okay.
See, he brought, this is a good one.
Okay.
And he brought two, too.
Okay.
So whoever my marker man is, he's the man. All right, so la yajuz, which means not permissible, right? And then? Yajuz, permissible, okay?
Okay.
So I'll give you a wasila.
Okay.
And you use your gut feeling. Which is empty, all right? To tell me if it goes in la yajuz
or yajuz,
not permitted or impermissible, or yajuz. Okay. Sound good? Mumtaz. Of course it sounds good.
Yes.
All right, let's see what I had.
Can I write in English, please?
No, I told him what it means. I interpreted. I'm teaching him right now. La yajuz, not permitted. Yajuz, permitted. Now I can't do anything about the bad handwriting. But as far as the words, I told him what it meant. Right, okay.
Rahamukallah.
Right, the first one, all right. I want to make tartib of the da'wah. I want to give it a tartib. So basically what I say is that I say to my du'at, my cadre of callers, I say we're going to make tartib of the da'wah, we're going to organize it this way, in this fashion. 3 days a week, I'm sorry, 3 days every week. And 10 days in a month, and 40 days in a lifetime. We have to dedicate to da'wah. This is how we're going to make tartib. That's the tartib I'm going to make. This is my wasila. Yajuz or la yajuz?
La yajuz.
La yajuz. Muttafiqeen? You guys all agree with that?
No.
Okay, so we'll put 3, 10, and 40 days. We'll put it in the category of la yajuz, okay? All right, let me give you another one. All right, using the microphone, this is the wasila, isn't it? It's a means to give da'wah, to project my voice to the people that I'm calling. This is a method.
Okay,
so what do you say about microphone? La yajuz or yajuz? Thank you, because I'm using it right now, right? Thank you. Thank you for that. Okay, next one. Next one I'm going to give you is videos, because they're filming this. A few people are filming it, right? So we make these videos, and then we can make DVDs and give those DVDs to people who want to call to Islam. We can post those DVDs on YouTube, and people around the world can watch those, learn about Islam. So what do you think about videos? You Jews or not you Jews? Thank you for that. Okay, videos. So we'll put videos over here, okay? All right, next one. Anasheed. Using Anasheed for Dawah. You guys know what Anasheed are?
Yeah.
Like poetry that's chanted. Sometimes accompanied by music, sometimes not accompanied by music. Totally a cappella, right? No music whatsoever, but they're chanting. They talk about, they have a chant, poetry about Rasulullah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right? Or they have a chant about the Battle of Badr. Or they have a chant where they just talk about Islam and the beauty of Islam. Okay? And they recite it beautifully, and it's very moving, and it has a very emotional effect on the one we call. That so many people have accepted Islam because of these anasheed. What do you say? You Jews or not you Jews?
Music?
I don't know, without music. The ones without music. Okay, let me see hands, because I hear some lap. I hear some lap.
Is there anything in the middle?
Yeah, okay, I'm going to put in the middle. So let me see hands for you Jews. Permissible.
No music.
I said, I promise, no music.
It's a man break now.
Anasheed, right? Anasheed with no music. All right, let me see, show of hands, Laya Jews. So there's Khilaf, but this is the minority.
You found one here.
Okay, so let's put here, I'm glad this happened. Because what we're going to do is we're going to circle back. I'm going to give you the Qa'idah, and we'll circle back and see what you say about Anasheed. So I'll write that in Arabic. Anasheed. Okay? Good? Anasheed, and we said it's that chanting poetry. Right? Mumtaz. Tayyip, let me give you another one. And I know what you're going to say about this one. What about using music in songs? We have like a band that comes, they play flutes, right? Laya Jews. Everybody agrees. All you got to shut the din, Mumtaz. Okay. Music is not allowed. Okay. All right, let me give you another one. What about using the Bible? Using the Bible. So I come and I meet with a Christian, and I start quoting verses and passages from the Bible, and I use it as a means to what? To convince him to be a Muslim. So I use the Bible. I said, come on, we're going to come with this New Testament, and oh, look, see, there's a contradiction here. Oh, see here, Jesus said he wasn't God. I used the Bible. You Jews are like you Jews. So here we go again. We have difference of opinion. Let me see. Show of hands, you Jews. Let me see. Show of hands, lay Jews. Lay Jews. Okay. All right. So we'll put the Bible. I'm so glad this happened, Yaqub. I'm so glad this happened. Fight Bible. All right. Let me give you a few more. All right. What about CDs? Using CDs. Everybody say it? Okay, mafi ikhtilaf. Okay, CDs.
Is it free or you have to pay for it?
Alright, what about books and pamphlets? Using books and pamphlets?
Jews.
Everybody says, only watching.
Don't spoil my business, man.
Alright, books and pamphlets? You Jews? By your final, akhir shay, online classes. We have an online class. Using online class. Somebody's pointing over there. What? Shoot. You can't see. I need to get out of the way. Put on your Jews. Okay. All right. So online classes, we said you Jews. But these, we don't come on after I give you the qaida. Okay, I'm going to give you the qaida, Khor. Basically, what the scholars have done, qadiman, whenever there was a new wasila, and when we say wasila, we mean what? A mean towards what? Towards the completion of an ibadah. To facilitate the performance of an ibadah. A new wasila would come. The scholars of Islam, what they would do is they would say, okay, shuf. We go back and we apply something called a sunnah at-talqiyah. A sunnah at-talqiyah. Ma'amana sunnah at-talqiyah. Basically, it is the concept, as mentioned by al-Shafi'iyyu wa ibn al-Qayyim. It is the concept that ma fa'alahu an-nabiy sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fa fi'luhu سنة وما تركه النبي فتركه سنة. Whatever the prophet did, doing it is the sunnah. Whatever the prophet left intentionally, purposely, is what? Leaving it is the sunnah. Leaving it is the sunnah. You guys got that? Fine. Okay, from that, they create what? A principle. And they say that whenever there's an ibadah, or a wasila, a means towards an ibadah, and it's something new, we look and we ask two questions. Did the Prophet and his companions, did they have a need to employ this wasila or to do this ibadah? Did they have a need? What we mean by need is either they had an actual need or doing it would have been advantageous. There would have been some benefit. You guys understand what I mean by need? What I mean by need, doing it, either they actually had an actual need, a pressing need, or doing it would have been advantageous. There would have been some benefit in them doing it. That's the first question they ask. The second question they ask is, was there anything that prevented them from doing it? They needed to do it, there was an advantage in doing it, but something did what? Prevented them. It was an obstacle in their path to what? To doing it. If they had a need and nothing prevented them from doing it, but they didn't do it, we say as sunnah tarkiyah is what? Applicable. It's in play. And therefore, leaving it is the sunnah. And doing it by default is bid'ah. Does that make sense? You guys follow me? Qaida. Qaida muttarida, useful, very useful in life. And it helps us to do what? It's almost like a device that we can use to do what? To put on bid'ah, sunnah. Bid'ah, sunnah. As opposed to what? Fatawa. Fatawa in which there could be what? Tanaquf. There could be contradiction. And it happens. They're human beings. Fahim to me, akhwani? Make sense?
Again, please.
Mumtaz. Again?
Again, please.
Fahim. Okay. So basically, you got the part about the sunnah tarqiyah. My father will never be you. You got that. From that, the scholars, they said, okay, what we do is whenever there's a wasila, or an act of worship itself, or a wasila, a means towards the completion, a means to facilitate an act of worship, we ask two questions. What's the first question? Did the Prophet and his companions have a need? Need. What we mean by need, it was advantageous. Doesn't mean that what? It doesn't necessarily mean need literally. Sometimes it means haja. They actually had a need to do it. And sometimes what? They had what? It would have been advantageous. It would have been beneficial if they did it. Second question, if they did have a need, if it would have been advantageous, was there anything that what? Prevented them. If they had a need and nothing prevented them, we say what? A sunnah tarqiyah is applicable, and therefore leaving this thing is a what?
Sunnah.
Leaving it is sunnah. Doing it would be, by default, bid'ah. Mumtaz. Let me give you an example, just to make sure we're on the same page. Tayyib al-Khwana, we go to masajid. And the Prophet in his time was very keen to do what? Straighten the rows. Does that make sense? Very keen. Very keen to straighten the rows. To the point that he would spend a long time going up and down the rows, making sure everybody was what? Straight. Sometimes he would appoint deputies. They would go up and down the rows for him. Sometimes he employed what? A stick, and he would do what? Push people back. Tap them on the chest so they would do what? Step back and make the rows straight. Sometimes he would entrust his companions to do it on their own. But before he would begin to pray, he would turn and he would say what? Tara-su. Yeah, tadilu. Stow. He would say something to what? Let them know, hey, straighten up your rows. Very keen. You guys with me? The Mumtaz. Tayyib. So, could we say that the Prophet had a need to put rope from one end of the masjid to the other?
Yeah.
No. Did he have a need?
Yes.
Who says no? Alhamdulillah. Lishno. He didn't have a need. He was keen to do this, and to put a rope would have been advantageous. Wouldn't it?
Yes.
Or to draw a line. Or to have some other means by which they could do what? Put their foot there and say, this is a straight line. Mm-hmm. Wouldn't that be advantageous?
Yes.
So they had a need. Remember, the word need doesn't mean need literally, but means it would have been advantageous. It would have facilitated. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Are we on the same page?
Yes, sir.
So there was a need for a rope or line or something.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's roll on to the next question.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Was there anything preventing the Prophet ﷺ and his companions from doing that?
No.
From taking a rope and stringing it from one wall to the other wall?
No.
From taking a stick
mm-hmm.
and putting it on the ground and burying it slightly?
Mm-hmm.
So the stick would slightly appear, it wouldn't be raised, mm-hmm. but they could use it as a straight line.
Mm-hmm.
Was there anything preventing him from drawing a line?
No.
Okay, so he needed to do it. Nothing stopped him from doing it. Did he do it?
No.
Even doing it becomes what?
Bid'ah.
Bid'ah. You agree about this?
Mumtaz. Yeah, I do personally.
Man, you my brother. Come on, man. There's a first man I hear that's second me.
All right, so now, ya ikhwani, we can come back to these, because we all understand the concept of sunnah at-tarkiyah. Make sense? All right, 3 days, 10 days, 40 days. Were we right?
Tabligh.
No.
Were we right?
No.
Should it be la yajuz or yajuz? Should we move this or leave it here?
La yajuz.
La yajuz, because the Prophet, it would have been advantageous to have this tarteeb. If this was a good tarteeb, it would have been advantageous.
Mm-hmm.
Was there anything stopping the Prophet from saying, hey, I'm going to send you out for 3 days, I'm going to send you out for 10 days, I'm going to send you out for 40 days?
Mm-hmm.
No.
No, nothing stopping him. Even not doing this is what?
Sunnah.
The sunnah. Doing it becomes?
Bid'ah.
Tayyib. Music. Ah, tawadha.
Okay, let me ask a question.
Ah, tawadha.
So, for example, let's say, you know, you want to do tartib in the sense to make it easier.
Uh-huh.
For you to do, like,
No. Don't mix me. Don't get it mixed up. A person says, I totally understand what you're saying. I just don't want to waste time. I totally understand what you're getting at. So does that mean that we can't be organized in doubt? That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that they fix this as if what? They fix this with the meaning of what? An afdaliyah.
Mm-hmm.
Or beyond afdaliyah, they make it what? A fard. Like this is how it's supposed to be.
Fard is different. No. Saying like, for example, every first weekend of the month,
uh-huh.
we go to this prison.
Okay.
This is just tartib.
Okay. But that's not what I mean by tartib. But let me say this. To answer your question, I'm going to ask you honestly, Akhwani. Is there anything we do غير محتف بالزمان والمكان? Is there anything we do that's not in the envelope of time and place?
No.
Is there anything that we do that we don't affix a time and a place?
No.
Like what makes affixing a time and a place haram when you say that this time or this place is what? Afdal. And you don't have a delil.
More rewarded.
That's where the problem comes with 3, 10, and 40. Make sense? Tafadhal, Sheikh.
Sheikh, it makes all the sense if they actually say what you just said.
Okay.
But if they actually say this is for an organizational, meet-organizational, nothing different than what we just did and say, I see for 20 years they've been meeting every 3 months.
Uh-huh.
So this Prophet ﷺ never did this.
Okay.
The CIC never said that this is afdaliyah.
Mumtaz.
So I think you need
to
distinguish this.
Okay, let me answer. Because he gave a good point. Let me answer. CIC, you said they meet once every 3 months. Okay. Suppose that time, it comes on a week or a day. You know, if we do it once every 3 months. So 3 months from the last meeting would fall on X day or Y day. Can they move it back? Can they move it forward?
Yes.
Because there's a need to do that?
Mm-hmm.
You go out with tabligh. Can you make this 2 days?
No.
Can you make it 4 days?
No!
That's why!
Okay.
You guys understand, Wasim?
Yeah.
I'm playing with you guys.
Right.
I'm not playing with you guys, and what I'm giving you is foolproof. Wallahi, I'm not going to bring some stuff. I just, it makes sense to me. Let me try this.
So, Sheikh, is it fair to say, if that was just merely...
If they just said 3 days because that's what's convenient for us.
No problem.
That would work.
Yeah.
But if I want, what they say is it has to be three.
Okay.
Can't be two. Can't be four. Has to be three. This can't be 11. It can't be 9. It has to be what? 10. And that's where the problem comes in. Wassel?
Yes.
Blast. Huh? If you don't mind.
No, I do.
Okay, go ahead.
No, because I got a lot of stuff.
Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
No, you see, between, see, I see as example, it's something local here.
Uh-huh.
But when you make it national, when you became in Egypt, in Syria, in India, and everywhere, and became something that everybody doing the same thing.
Oh.
This has become sunnah.
Subhanallah. Like, all right, so we're all on the same page, Ikhwan? Mumtaz.
Almost.
All right, now we come to Mike. Want to change your opinion?
No.
Why?
Because they have
advantageous, but there was something that prevented it. Technology didn't exist.
Yes.
While then,
yeah.
Then we're on the right page. Videos.
Yes.
Advantageous?
Same.
Technology exists?
Same.
So there's something preventative. We're on the right page. Like CDs. Advantageous?
Same.
All day long. But what? Technology didn't exist. Books and pamphlets. Advantageous?
Yes.
But the technology?
It
did not exist. Like online classes. No, they didn't have. You know what they had to do?
Scrolls.
They had to write everything by hand. The books were what? Totally cumbersome. And everything pretty much at that time was what they call oral transmission. They had everything up here. They had everything up here. The person would travel to read a book and then do what?
Memorize it.
And even there's a quote from, I don't know if it's Malik or Shafi. It's Malik. He said, وَمَا كَتَبَ أَحَدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيَحْفَظْ فَإِذَا حَفِظْ مَسَحَ مَا كَتَبْ. They would write to memorize. And once they memorize, they would do what? They would erase it. وَعَفْ يَخْوَانْ طَيْ مُمْتَزْ طَيْ. Okay, let's come now to what?
What about the music part? Did you
miss that? Okay, wait, يَخْوَانْ. All right, what I want you to do now, briefly, is I want you to think. I'm not going to ask immediately. Just go back to the principle. Now, I want you to look at what? An Ashid. Look at the Bible. And I want to see if you want to put it here or you want to put it here. Ta'ammal. Think about it. Don't be hasty because Allah doesn't like haste. Haste is from the shaitan. But just remember these two questions. Advantageous? Yes or no?
Yes.
If we say yes to the first, we come to another question. Anything preventing?
No.
If we say no to the second question, we have to put it where? Okay, so ta'ammalu. I'll give you a few seconds. And I think we should all agree on this. If we don't agree, I'm going to walk out. All right? Ladies, we better agree.
All right.
All right now. Anashid. Anashid. In da'wah, la yajuz. In da'wah, la yajuz. You want to play anashid for your children at home with no music? Go ahead. You want to use anashid as a wasila for da'wah? La yajuz. Leesh. Because it was advantageous and there was nothing stopping the Prophet. No better poets than the poets of what? Of the Prophet's time. Right? Okay? So they could have done this. Advantageous, definitely. That they loved poetry. Poetry, to them, was the highest art form. Okay? Wouldn't that have been a great wasila? Would have been a great wasila. Anything stopping them?
Nope.
Didn't the Prophet have a poet?
Yes.
Hassan ibn
Thabit.
So he can say Hassan ibn Thabit make some what? Some? An ashid. Could have done it. Nothing prevented him from doing it. Didn't do it. That means they say?
Layajus.
In da'wah. That's the key thing. In da'wah. As a wasila for da'wah. By using the Bible.
Afwan. But it can be, it's of defense, as example.
The Bible, you mean?
No. The anashid.
Some anashid?
Qala kum fahjuhum ya Hassan.
Well, it wasn't, but that was called anashid,
so
though. Anashid is a little bit different, I think anashid is a little bit different. We can argue about later.
I'm not talking about, we're talking in da'wah, and I'm saying you use it as a whipping.
Anashid, though.
This
It's what he did.
Okay, all right, come on. We can argue about it later.
So I'm asking clarity only. Is there a difference between Anashid and Qasid and like Alfi ibn al-Malik, Alfi ibn this and that?
See, I think so. But we can argue about it later.
Yeah, well, no need for argue. Let's go. We talk about the koala we eat in the dinner.
Bible. Using the Bible.
Yes.
You Jews or lay Jews?
You Jews.
You Jews use the Bible?
Yes.
Anji, why?
Yes.
Why?
Okay.
Okay, first of all, the Bible, would it have been advantageous to use the Bible during the time of the Prophet? Would it have been advantageous to argue with Christians, Methelin? I mean, we could argue. Let's just say, for the sake of argument, it would have been advantageous to use their book against them. Although, I think, if you use their book, you're almost admitting its legitimacy. And they can use it against you. And you can't say, okay, I'm going to use this passage against you. And they can say, well, this passage is for me. You say, oh, no, I don't believe in that. Okay, either this is legitimate or just not. But let's, okay. So let's just say, for the sake of argument, advantageous. Advantageous, did the prophet do it?
Yes.
No. Did the prophet do it? He used the Bible.
Yes.
When he used the Bible?
Yes.
Give me.
Adi ibn Hatim visited the Prophet sallallahu alayhi
wa sallam.
He's the son of Hatim al-Tayy. And he sat in front of the Prophet sallallahu
alayhi wa sallam.
The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, you're Adi, you're the chief of your people. You take the fifth one. فولك الخمس وهذا عندكم. When the ayah, اتخذوا أحبارهم ورهبانهم أربابا من دون الله. فقال ما اتخذناهم. We didn't take them أربابا. He said, no, you did. You take the fifth of what your people, your people give you the fifth. And that's what your Ahbar and Ruhban dictated. So you actually followed what the Ahbar and Ruhban dictated. And that's how they make tashri' for you. So the point, the shahid, the Prophet knew what their Bible says.
No, knowing is one thing.
And he used
using the Bible.
And he used it to make da'wah.
Just one example. One of the Sahabas, when the Prophet frowned, and he said, the Prophet frowned, and he said, if Musa was here, he would be following me. He was reading the Torah.
The hadith of Umar would be an excellent proof to prove this point.
Exactly.
If it were authentic.
If we take if it this authentic. As a guidance.
If it were authentic.
Anyway.
If it were authentic. So the hadith of Umar would be awesome if it were authentic.
Yeah.
But it's not. But what you said is not a proof either. It's not
making,
using the Bible.
He was making da'wah.
I'm going to give you a perfect example.
There was no Bible.
Let me give you an example. There was a Bible.
No, nothing. But the Prophet knew what the Bible said.
Okay, let me say this.
Okay.
Let me say this.
At least we agree about five, three, one only, so we can leave it for later. We can discuss it.
All right.
That we reach a great... So let's keep giving the da'wah. Okay? Now leave this issue of Bible to study more.
Mumtaz. That's a good point. That's a good point.
This is not the end.
Kullu qaida istisna.
Baby Akhwan, so Mumtaz.
Go ahead.
We got it. We got the qaida.
Yes.
And it's our weapon to do what? To determine between what?
Yajuz
wa la yajuz fi shay?
Permits in da'wah.
Fi da'wah. Okay, make sense?
All right,
so it's not...
don't want to get in trouble.
This one...
Qaida, please.
This one... I see what you're saying. I didn't get that. It went right over my head. So this one, we'll talk about it. Okay, let's keep going.
Keep going, please.
Just before you move on this, just a point of tarbiyah to us. Is it fair to say that what you taught us, which I fully respect and agree with you, is not Quran? These qaida are ijtihad from the ulama.
Well, they derive it from what?
Very good. They did not make ijma on it, so they differed on it. So is it fair to say that this is in general a great tool for you to distinguish?
Yeah.
However, we should not give the tarbiyah that anyone disagrees with this qaida. We
disagree. Oh, no, evident. I thank you for mentioning that. That's important. That's really important. I really appreciate you mentioning that. Jazakallah khair.
Good point.
Very good point.
Yes.
All right, so now let me move, because we spent a lot of time. What time do you guys want to stop?
We have about 10 minutes more.
10 minutes?
15.
Oh,
man, I won't.
Half an hour.
All right, Tayyib, let's go and then you just stop me.
Okay.
All right, Tayyib. So next thing I wanted to mention, I can actually sit down now because we're done with the board. If it's okay with you guys, I'll sit down. All right, so the next thing I want to mention is when it comes to a da'wah, we talk about these wasa'il, that the prophets and messengers, They are our role models. When it comes to everything, including a da'wah. All the prophets and messengers, we look at them and we look at how they approached it, especially who? Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the Prophet specifically, he says, وَلَقَدْ كَانَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسْنَةٌ. You have in the Messenger of Allah the most excellent example. And he said about the prophets in general, أُولَٰئِكَ he said, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ هَدَوْهُمُ اللَّهُ هَدَاهُمُ اللَّهُ فَبِهُدَاهُمْ مُقْتَدِينَ. He says, these are the ones who Allah has guided. So, follow
their guidance.
Follow their guidance, okay? So these are our role models. So what we do is, or what we should do, when we start talking about the concept of wasail, is we should look at the methods that they employ, the techniques that they use. That should be our primary source when it comes to what? Giving da'wah. And we should try our best that whatever we do, we can actually justify it, substantiate it in their practice, in their custom. And this is the way we can make sure that we don't deviate and fall into what? Things which are not permitted. If we make that a fundamental principle. All right, now we come to the issue of why. Why should we study the techniques and the means, the asalib and the wasail of da'wah? Why should we study this in the first place? Why is it beneficial? The first thing, ikhwan, is because what this does, it will increase the da'i in his effectiveness. This will increase the da'i in his effectiveness. Imagine, ikhwan, that let's just make a similitude. Let's say that the person who you're giving da'wah to is like a broken alah. It's like a device, a machine that's broken. Okay? And you want to repair it. You want to make it right. You want to fix it. Okay? But you don't have any tools. You don't have any tools. So your attempts to repair the alah, will they be effective?
No.
No, they won't be effective, but not because you're not intelligent, not because you don't have the wherewithal, you don't have the desire, you don't have the good intentions, but because you don't have the necessary tools, you won't be effective. Okay?
They break it even.
Tayyip, another reason why we study these techniques is because it enables the caller to do what? To vary his techniques. Vary his techniques to suit the condition of the one he calls. Mm-hmm. Let's go back to the similitude. We have not one machine that's broken, we have 10. And they all have different faults. Okay? Let's use heaters as an example. I have one heater, it doesn't heat up. I have another heater, so the first one turns on but doesn't heat up. Second one doesn't turn on. Third one doesn't turn off. Next one, it's stuck on high fan. So you switch to low fan but it doesn't go to low fan, it stays. All these different faults, okay? So now I want to repair all five heaters, but I only have one tool. So with that one tool, I may be able to repair one or two of them, but will I be able to repair all of them?
No.
No. But if I have a tool belt with many different tools, all the tools that a heater repairman needs, doesn't matter what the fault is, I can fix it as long as I have the knowledge. Does that make sense? That's another reason why we study the wasail. The more techniques that we learn, the more we can do what? Vary the techniques. That's to make them, to use a technique which is most suited to the one that we are calling. Because the people we call, are they all the same?
No.
No, Ebedan, you have people you call and they're intellectuals. You have another person you call and the person he's almost illiterate. You have another person you call, he's a firm believer in God. Another person you call, he's a atheist. You have another person you call, who he is sympathetic, interested, intrigued by Islam. Another person you call, he's totally what? Opposed to Islam. Can we call them all the same?
No.
Evident. Each one needs a different tool or different technique. Does it make sense, Ya Khwani? So this is why we need to learn these what? These asalib. And it's incumbent upon the da'i to what? Or what this teaches us is incumbent upon the da'i before he gives da'wah to do what? To know the condition of what? Al-Mad'u. To know the condition of the one he calls. Know who he's dealing with. He can't just rush in. He can't just rush in. Right? It's just like people go and they're going to take a building. SWAT. They need to know what's going on what? Inside. On the inside. Because if they just rush in with pepper spray. And these guys have, you know, they have automatic weapons, semi-automatic weapons. What's they get slaughtered? Is that not so? They need to know what's going on inside before they rush in. Does that make sense? Same thing with the da'i. He needs to know what he's dealing with so he can what? Prepare the proper tools. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ in the Hadith of Ibn Abbas, collected by Bukhari Muslim, when he was going to send Mu'adh ibn Jabal to Yemen, what did he say? Ya Mu'adh, innaka ta'ti qawman ahla kitab. Oh Mu'adh, you're going to go to what? People from the people of the book. Make sense? You need to know who you're dealing with, Mu'adh. These are people of the book. Okay? Tayyib. So now what we're going to do is, we're going to look at some techniques. Ala ujala. We're going to do it quickly because I'm depriving you guys of lunch. Don't want to do that. All right, so the first, I'm going to give you three jumlatan. Three all together, bundle them together, because they all have the same dalil. The first one is a tadarruj. That when you give, when you make da'wah, you do so in incremental stages. You don't give the person everything at what? At once. Don't do that, yaqwan. Take them like a baby. Incremental steps. At-tadarruj. And wasn't this the way of your Prophet? Sallallahu Allah taught him this. Made it practically, almost, I won't say, forced it to be like that. Gave him the Qur'an, peace of me. In accordance with what? The circumstances. And in accordance with the iman of the people who he was brought to what? To call. Notice that? The Prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, first he wanted to prohibit wine. But he didn't come and just what? Prohibit it outright. First he put them on notice. So he said, يَسْأَلُونَكَ الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ قُلْ فِيهِمَا إِثْمٌ كَبِيرٌ وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ وَإِثْمُهُمَا أَكْبَرُ مِنْ نَفْعِهِمَا. So the first thing he did, he said, they ask you about wine. Not going to prohibit it right now. But answer them and tell them, فِيهِمَا إِثْمٌ كَبِيرٌ. In these two things, gambling and wine is a great sin. وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ. And many benefits for people. وَإِثْمُهُمَا أَكْبَرُ. But the sin is greater than the benefit. What does that do? Puts you on notice. It's coming. It didn't come yet, but let me brace myself. Much better than what? If it just hit them like a ton of bricks. Make sense? Then it was, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَأْتُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَقْرَبُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَأَنْتُمْ سُكَارَى. Right? Oh, you who believe, don't come to the prayer and you are intoxicated. You are inebriated. Right? So, okay. We don't have to stop altogether. But we can't do it at the times of what? The prayers. Right? And then after that, it was totally prohibited. You see that? See how Allah implemented this with His Prophet ﷺ? And the Prophet applied it and practiced it the same way the da'i has to be with what? The people he calls. يتدرج. ثم بعد ذلك, the da'i needs to be organized and systematic. He needs to be organized and systematic. He can't be what? He can't be all over the place. He can't be chaotic. So he starts out talking about tawheed. And he starts talking about what? Hijab. Comes back, terrorism. And never finishes one subject. Be organized. Next thing, al-bada' bil-aham fal-muhim. Begin with the, prioritize. Begin with the most important thing and then do what? And then go from that successively to what? The thing which follows it in importance. And then what follows it in importance. And the proof for all of these three is the hadith of what? Ibn Abbas, the Bukhari Muslim, that Mu'adh was sent to Yemen. And the Prophet ﷺ, he said to him, Ya Mu'adh, إِنَّكَ تَأْتِ قَوْمًا أَهْلَ كِتَابٍ فَلْيَكُنْ أَوَّلْ مَا تَدْعُوهُمْ إِلَيْكَ أَنْ يَشْهَدُوا أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ فَإِنْ أَطَاعُوكَ بِذَلِكَ فَأَخْبِرْهُمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ فَرَضَ عَلَيْهِمْ خَمْسَ صَلَوَاتٍ فِي كُلِّ يَوْمٍ وَلَيْلَةٍ فَإِنْ أَطَاعُوكَ بِذَلِكَ فَأَخْبِرْهُمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ فَرَضَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَدَقَةً تُؤْخَذُ مِنْ أَغْنِيَائِهِمْ فَتُرَدُّ عَلَى فُقَرَائِهِمْ. So he told Mu'adh, he said, oh Mu'adh, you're going to go to the people, some people from the people of the book. So the first thing you call them to be what? The shahada, the testimony of faith. فَإِنَ ضَعُولَكَ Teach them about tawheed. If they accept it, if they embrace it, then succeed to what? As-salat. So he said, فَإِنَ ضَعُولَكَ Which means what? If they don't accept the tawheed, then don't what? Don't go to a salat. So he's teaching them what? At-tadarruj. Teaching with what? Al-Badr bin Aham. Aham shayya ikhwani at-tawheed. The most important thing is tawheed. Because a person could pray, a person could fast, a person gives zakat, a person could make hajj every year. If he doesn't have a tawheed, it will not what? Not benefit him. So teach him a tawheed, Mu'adh. If they accept it, then teach them salat. If they don't accept it, keep teaching them, keep inviting them to what? A tawheed. So he told them what? Al-Badr bin Aham fa fal-muhim. From shayya ikhwani? طيب ممتاز. So that's three techniques. طيب ثم بعد ذلك, the fourth technique, and I like to title it in this way. You can catch more flies with honey. You can catch more flies with honey. Critical technique, ya khwani, when you call people to Allah, you need to be what? Kind. You need to be gentle. You need to be hayyin, layyin. You can't be what? You can't be tough. You can't be tough. And I want to say this, ya khwani, this is not just for the non-Muslims. In fact, the Muslims are what? Awla. The Muslims have more right to our kindness than what the non-Muslims. And what we find is that when we deal with a Muslim, and we want to give that Muslim da'wah, because we do give da'wah to Muslims, don't we? We give them nasiha. But what you find is that a person will be so kind to the non-Muslims. They'll bend over backwards, they'll make compromises to bring the non-Muslim to Islam. And then their Muslim brother, he has some issues. He comes to the masjid, which means he's making effort. And they do what? They light him on fire. They light him on fire! And they do! And then they'll turn around and you ask them, you know, what's this double standard? Al-Kaylbi Mikyalin. You ask him about this double standard. Oh, I believe da'wah is the most important thing. We have to bring the non-Muslims. Yeah, that's beautiful. But why don't you apply with what? The Muslims who are older. Muhammad Rasulullah. وَلَذِينَ مَعْهُ أَشِدَّاءُ وَالْكُفَّارِ رُحَمَا أَيْنَ الرَّحْمَةِ أَيْنَ الرَّحْمَةِ يَا أَخْوَانِي I'm asking you, isn't this Muslim more entitled to your patience? More entitled to your tolerance? More entitled to your mercy than what? A non-Muslim. Doesn't mean the non-Muslims are not entitled. But the Muslim is more entitled. Be patient, be gentle with your Muslim brother. إِنَّ اللَّهَ رَفِيقٌ يُحِبُّ الرِّفْقِ يُعْطِي الرِّفْقِ مَا لَا يُعْطِي الْعُمْفِ That's the other thing too, in the naqil. Person has to use common sense. Allah is gentle. And He loves gentleness. That should be enough. The hadith could stop there. The fact that Allah loves it should be enough tashjir. Allah loves it, I want to do it. To do something that Allah loves. But the hadith goes on. يُعْطِي الرِّفْقِ He gives in exchange as a result, as a consequence of gentleness, what He doesn't give as a consequence of shiddah. He's not going to give it. You seek something, but you're not going to get it by these means. In most cases, the person does what? Turns away. He doesn't come back. I went to the masjid. I tried. And this is what they did to me. I'm not going over there. ثم بعد ذلك another wasila.
I'm sorry.
You want to stop?
No. I'm not want to stop. But I have to give my boss how much time more?
Okay, I think we can do 10 minutes and we'll finish. Okay? All right.
No question answers.
Okay, خلاص.
Only 10 minutes for lecture?
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, and we can, those who would like to hear more, they can come back after the Eid.
Okay. All right, so the next, Jameel, let you right here. Whatever you say, you're the boss. طيب, next one, so we did, we did four. Okay, five. Action, speak louder. Action, speak louder.
Speak louder.
Actions speak louder. Speak loud, Nay Shay.